Welcome to the P.A.S. Report Weekly Roundup Podcast. The P.A.S. Report provides an honest analysis on the critical issues that matter to you without the biased media filters. Here's your host, Professor Nicholas Giordano.
What's up, everyone? Welcome to the P.A.S. Report Podcast. This is your host, Nick Giordano, and I got another fantastic episode lined up for you. As always, make sure to follow and subscribe to the podcast so you never miss an episode. Also, visit the P.A.S. Report website, PASReport.com. And share the podcast with your family, friends, and on social media. Now, as of this recording, I can't believe I have to say this, but World War III hasn't started yet. And we're going to see how things continue to unfold. However, we do see this conflict continuing to expand, and it appears that it is only a matter of time before the powder keg within the Middle East ignites, sending us and the world into a place that we don't really want to be. You know, and it's undeniable that we find ourselves in a time marked by this uncertainty, and much of this uncertainty is directly because of the leadership void that we see, not just globally, but here in the United States. We have to be candid about this. The thought of President Biden leading us through a possible world war is terrifying, and this is not to say that President Biden is responsible for the Hamas attacks on Israel. I'm not blaming him. Hamas attacks happened long before he became president, and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict goes back decades, spanning multiple administrations. These attacks, there's a deep-rooted history, there's a history of hate there. They transcend any one administration. And when we look at Hamas, when you really truly understand the nature of this terrorist organization, you have to understand that Israel relinquished total control of Gaza in 2005. They dismantled all the Israeli settlements, and Gaza was free to govern themselves. And the Palestinians, they chose Hamas, and Hamas has ruled with an iron fist, and all the aid they received, because you have a bunch of morons in the international community just sending over money over the past decade and a half, sending tens of billions of dollars, that's all gone to the Hamas infrastructure. None of it has gone to the people. So I'll constantly say the Palestinian suffering is a direct result of Hamas. Now, when we look at the situation that's going on, I may not hold the president accountable for the Hamas attacks. However, where I do hold him accountable is his handling of the Afghanistan withdrawal debacle that unfolded before the eyes of the world. This event, as I discussed in the previous episode, has set off a chain reaction in international affairs. It's the catalyst for much of what is going on today. The truth is that regardless of our military supremacy, the perception of our strength has been called into question. In politics, you have to realize perception holds so much weight. Imagine having the most formidable military force that has ever existed. Imagine spending two decades in Afghanistan, only to witness the Taliban reclaiming control as we exit, only to witness the Taliban to become more powerful than they were when we first invaded in 2001. It's an embarrassment. And that's what it is. It's an embarrassment. There's no other way to put it. It's historical, and it hurt our standing in the international community. Ask yourselves, following Afghanistan, do our adversaries now view us with more fear or less? Do they regard President Biden with more respect or less? Since Biden took office in 2001, has the world become a more stable place under his leadership? I mean, let's be honest here. Does anyone feel safer that Joe Biden is president right now? Can anyone say that President Biden instills a sense of confidence that everything is going to be okay? That we could overcome any challenge? Can anyone say that this administration has been a success? And again, be honest with yourselves. Doesn't matter where you stand on the political aisle. Just look at what's taken place since he's been in office. Would Russia have invaded Ukraine? Would China have shown increasing aggression throughout the Pacific and the rest of the world? Would Iran be emboldened? Would any of these things be happening if we executed an organized peaceful withdrawal from Afghanistan led by a president projecting strength? Now, of course, this is speculation on my part, but you know your gut is telling you that I'm right. Even if we disagree on the political issues, I am right. And again, I'll reiterate, President Biden is not responsible for the Hamas attacks. It could happen under any administration. However, it's the broader context of the simultaneous conflicts that amplifies this one, and where this conflict has the potential to go. Without all the other incidents that exist around the world, without the growing aggression of our adversaries, the war in Gaza would be an isolated incident. It would be manageable. However, given everything going on, this only adds to the international stability. And this can quickly expand beyond regional borders. And that's what we're beginning to see. However, the last 3 weeks have been really revealing. You know, the world's devolving into chaos. American families are getting crushed economically. And yet what I've seen over the last 3 weeks, it disgusts me. We have so many issues going on. And we see these protests of people defending the slaughter of over 1,400 people in Israel, innocent civilians, including 32 Americans. And what do we hear in these protests? Well, we hear chants for the abolishment and destruction of Israel and Israelis. Think about that for a second. Where is this going? Why are so many in the United States calling for a genocide? You know, they accuse Israel of doing an ethnic cleansing. That's the accusation. But it's Hamas, Hezbollah, and Iran that actually call for an ethnic cleansing day in, day out. You have these idiotic students on college campuses and in high schools staging walkouts, chanting from river to sea, Palestine will be free, which is nothing more than a call for the elimination of Israel. I doubt that they know what that slogan actually means. They could display outrage towards the Hamas massacre and still be sympathetic to Palestinians, and yet they're not doing that. Why? Because of a failed education system, that's why. Rather than denounce Hamas, these students are unwittingly calling for a second Holocaust. And it's clear that they know nothing about the first Holocaust that took place. But don't worry, everyone, because they tell us that our diversity is our strength. And that's what I want to focus on in this episode. The diversity is our strength myth. So hang tight, we'll be right back. When things go sideways, you want to be prepared. Protect you and your family. And people are concerned. They might have to go for a long time without food, electricity. That's why I want to introduce you to 4patriots.com. Get preparedness products you could use now and that could save your life later. My favorite is 4patriots' new solar generator, the Patriot Power Generator 2000X. It uses the endless free power of the sun to power your lights, your TV, medical equipment, even run your fridge. Plus, it's expandable and comes with a free solar panel. Or you could pick up one of 4patriots' best-selling survival food kits. Delicious taste and designed to last for 25 years. They even have kits with real meat. And if the power's out, no worries. Just boil water over fire, simmer, and serve. You're going to enjoy a hot meal and stay safe in a crisis. More smart people than ever are finding 4Patriots. Over 2 million customers trust them, and you might have even seen them on TV. I had the folks at 4Patriots set up a special page for you at 4patriots.com/PAS so that listeners of this podcast can see this week's discounts and deals before they go away. Go to 4patriots.com/PAS, but you got to hurry because the deals don't last long. So save more money, get peace of mind, and protect you and your family. Go to 4patriots.com/PAS. Welcome back, everyone. So part of the reason we're in this mess is because of the public virtue signalers that the Democrat Party has become beholden to. And it's not just here in the United States. It's happening in the entire Western world. However, this is going to lead to national suicide. And we're seeing how. You have a bunch of morons that would rather pat themselves on the back for being noble holy warriors than recognize the damage they are inflicting throughout our society. For too long, the diversity is our strength mantra has echoed throughout Western society. And it may sound nice. It may sound virtuous. It may sound reassuring. But it's all bullshit, and it doesn't hold up to scrutiny. Right now, we stand at a crossroads that's going to shape our future, and the last 2 weeks should have opened a lot of eyes. Unfortunately, so many people would rather operate on emotions and empty platitudes rather than use reason, logic, and common sense. I keep hearing that our politics is so divided, but that's always been true. Division is natural in a free society, particularly when it comes to political issues. If you want unity on the political issues, then go to North Korea, go to communist China, go to any dictatorship out there. That's where you see unity on political issues. Here, we have a problem because we have these bunch of wannabe authoritarians. We have a bunch of little Mussolini wannabes. And the left believes that if you don't bow to their political issues, it's that division that threatens our republic. Therefore, they want to force people to adopt bad ideas. See, their version of unity is unity through submission. It's why they use words like purge, re-educate, and deprogram whenever they refer to their political opponents. And now we could add in formal deprogramming, as Hillary Clinton suggested a few weeks ago. It's why they label everyone bigots and racists, misogynists, because they want to demean their political opposition. They want to isolate our political opposition. But the truth is that being divided on political issues is not dangerous. In fact, it is actually healthy. It's natural in a free society. It fosters different opinions, calls for more robust debate, giving people the ability to think critically. What is dangerous is the division when it comes to American values. There is a difference between being divided on political issues and being divided on the entire premise of the United States and what we stand for. Undermining the premise of the United States and American values is what really, truly endangers the Republic. Undermining and demeaning the Constitution is what threatens the Republic. And in order for our nation to survive, we need a paradigm shift. We need a paradigm shift away from these toxic far-left ideas, this progressive ideology that will destroy our nation through self-inflicted wounds, death by a thousand cuts, like diversity is our strength. What we need is to return to the roots of what has made our nation thrive. See, while the idea, the concept of diversity does offer some unique benefits, and there are some benefits, so just think. Think about all the different foods. I mean, if it wasn't for Italians coming over here, Italian food wouldn't really exist here. And Italian food is the best food out there. Take pizza. You had Italians come over, they Americanize it here in New York, some go to Chicago, they Americanize it there, they create the deep dish pizza. And you could take that with any culture that exists out there. Japanese hibachi, Mexican food, Chinese food, doesn't matter. Practices like yoga, meditation, learning about different cultures and traditions, all those things are great, they're phenomenal. But it's assimilation that forges a resilient and united America, not diversity. Diversity is a bunch of nonsense. Over the last 40 years, we have witnessed a dramatic shift. See, it used to be that when immigrants came over here, and I'm talking about both legal and illegal immigrants, when they came to the United States, in order to be part of the American system, they had to willingly embrace core American values and customs. That wasn't a concession. It was mandatory. And it was necessary to celebrate the uniqueness of America. This is the process that ensures our survival and affirms our commitment to the principles of liberty and freedom, economic mobility, to a sense of nationhood that's going to foster nationalism, motivating us to be there for one another. Yes, that very system, you were required to adapt to the American system. However, this changed with the radical progressive movement, where no longer is it acceptable to force assimilation on immigrants. Rather than an immigrant conforming to American values and customs, America had to surrender to the values and customs of those coming here. We couldn't judge. It's not the person coming here that should assimilate to the American culture, rather it's America that should assimilate and bow to other cultures. And we're seeing the effects are on display today, especially over the last couple of weeks. We're witnessing the consequences of diversity is our strength. Nothing more than a myth, because this diversity is our strength mantra has fractured our society. When people come to our country or any Western country, we don't want them to simply reside and dwell within the borders. That doesn't strengthen any nation. Just look at European countries, particularly countries like France and Britain. They take people from place B, bring them to place A, settle them with people from place B. In the process, those individuals never learn about place A. They don't assimilate to the customs and values of place A. They don't gain an appreciation for place A. They don't gain a sense of loyalty to place A. Instead, they want place A to bow and conform to them and their ideals. They essentially want place A to become place B, the very place they escaped from. So it doesn't really make sense in the end, but that's what they want. And they'll just destroy place A. That's what happens when you don't have an assimilation process. And sadly, the Western world and our values are under siege from within. And it's not really the fault of the people that are just getting here. It's the fault of a bunch of self-entitled middle to upper middle class brats who live in a world where they're inoculated from all the horrors of how the real world actually works, where they didn't have to sacrifice anything. They had it pretty good. The biggest threat to our society is a bunch of suburban white women and emasculated men who have no understanding what the world is really like, how cruel the world could really be, who believe that their virtue signaling makes them a good person. And it's not that they want to be a good person, they just want to be validated. They want everyone to see what a good person they are, how noble and holy they are. And they push this crap, their bad ideas throughout society. It's so bizarre how America and the Western world are afflicted with this sense of self-loathing. To the social justice warriors and the public virtue signalers, the West is an evil place built on injustices. It's far from reality, it's not true. The West has done more for humanity than any civilization that has ever existed. And it's not to say that we're perfect. It's not to say that we haven't committed sin or made mistakes. We certainly have. But the idea that Western civilization is built on evil and continues to remain so, it's complete nonsense. What really makes this phenomenon strange is that we constantly hold ourselves to a different standard than other parts of the world, as they routinely criticize our culture and preach about how they care about human beings and human rights. They don't dare criticize other cultures. And it's because deep down, they're the ones that are a real racist. They're the ones that are a real bigots. Okay, the reason they hold the West to a much higher standard is because they believe that the other peoples around the world are simply uncivilized. That's what it comes down to. That the reason they act a certain way is because of the Western world and the dominance that we've had and how we've inflicted and taken advantage of developing and third world countries. And it shows you the stupidity of the whole movement. I mean, listen, I was watching a video the other day and it was funny, but at the same time it was sad because this is going on in our backyard. You have members of the LGBT community protesting against Israel, calling Israel a human rights abuser, calling Israel for the destruction and elimination of Israel. And an LGBT group decided that they were going to stand with the Palestinians. They were going to march with the Palestinians for justice. And it doesn't dawn on these morons that Palestinians don't really stand with you. I mean, look at how gay people are treated in Palestine, especially Gaza. What do you think they do with someone who is gay or someone who identifies as trans? And in one of the protests supporting Palestinians, someone tried to march with a pride flag. And let's just say from the video that I saw, it didn't go so well. It didn't work out for that person. But remember, diversity is our strength. And I find it so interesting how many within America are quick to criticize the United States. They're quick to label the United States inherently racist. They're quick to say that diversity is our solution. If we get rid of the white majority that built our system for racist purposes, well, then things will improve. Yet the same people, they rarely, if ever, criticize a country like China and how Uyghurs are being systematically detained, forced into labor camps, tortured and killed. Christians being targeted in China as well, but you don't hear about that. You won't hear those truths from the social justice warriors who pretend to care about human rights because they're frauds. You'll never hear criticism of Muslim countries for the treatment of women. Or what about how gay people are treated throughout many African and Middle Eastern and Asian societies? You don't hear a peep from them. And obviously the people from those cultures don't have the same level of self-hatred in their own nations. This is only a Western thing. This is a Western phenomenon. These people, they come to hate their own societies from within. They hate the culture. They can't even muster up common truths about the progress we've made throughout history, about the contributions that we've made, about how we have been a system for justice. Again, not all the time, but overall, we have a pretty damn good track record. And when a civilization stops believing in itself, when a civilization is unwilling to defend the values that have led to our greatness, values like liberty, freedom, democratic principles, free inquiry, how can any society survive that? When it all comes crashing down, it's going to be interesting to see their reaction, because I guarantee you these social justice warriors, the public virtue signalers, they're going to be the first ones to be screaming and complaining. Let's be honest, these are the same people that will preach one thing, and then when they have to live by what they preach, well, no, not in my backyard. You can't send the migrants to my backyard. We're a sanctuary city in a sanctuary state, we declared. All immigrants are welcome here, but no, we can't handle it. Not in our backyard. Again, they're frauds. But if it's really about diversity and diversity is our strength, well, we wouldn't have any of these issues, right? Because we are the most diverse, unique nation that exists out there. There's no other place like ours where all these people from different places come together, coexist together. If it really is about diversity, should we import people whose culture values males over females because they come from male-dominated societies? And should we accept that type of viewpoint? Should we import people from cultures that throw gay people off rooftops in the name of diversity? Should we do that? Should we import people consumed but with hatred for other groups? You see the idiocy behind the diversity is our strength myth. But even worse is how the assimilation process dies because diversity is our strength. And I'm going to explain that when we get back from this quick break. Welcome back, everyone. So we've seen a push to say that the melting pot, the idea of assimilation, they're racist concepts. In fact, some universities have declared the concept of a melting pot as a racial microaggression. And they say that a person's racial and ethnic experiences shouldn't be denied, that an individual is a racial and cultural being. That's what happens when you look at everything through the prism of the color of one's skin or the ethnicity that they come from. And then people wonder why college campuses have become so radicalized. Every single bad idea that exists within society usually comes from the universities, but by those who think that they're so much smarter than everyone else because they have a PhD. They went through all this schooling. And I will tell you, there are some people with PhDs that are extraordinarily smart, but most are morons. Let's understand that. They have no clue how reality actually works. And the reason that I'm successful as a teacher is because long before I was full-time in the classroom, I had a job. I actually worked outside of the classroom. I wasn't solely steeped in academia. And so I know how the real world actually operates. I know how it operates through growing up in my childhood. But these PhDs, the elitist attitude, their bad ideas seep into our society and it destroys our society. These are the same people that push this global citizen crap. They say citizenship is an accident by birth. Not for nothing. But when it comes to America and the assimilation process, I think Teddy Roosevelt was spot on when he remarked that there is no room in this country for hyphenated Americanism. When I refer to hyphenated Americans, I do not refer to naturalized citizens. Some of the very best Americans I have ever known were naturalized Americans, Americans born abroad. But a hyphenated American is not an American at all. This is just as true of the man who puts native before the hyphen as of the man who puts German or Irish or English or French before the hyphen. Americanism is a matter of the spirit and of the soul. Our allegiance must be purely to the United States. We must unsparingly condemn any man who holds any other allegiance. But if he is heartily and singly loyal to the Republic, then no matter where he was born, he is just as good an American as anyone else. That really encapsulates everything. If those coming here don't get an appreciation of American customs and values, if those coming here don't shed some of their cultural identity of their native countries, how can we expect them to be loyal to the United States? How can we expect them to adopt American values, American culture? How can we expect them to put the country above culture? See, what they're sending, the message that they're sending is that culture is above country. And identity politics is the key to constantly dividing people. When you consistently say everything is about recognizing the special and unique cultures over the United States and the idea of the United States, you are creating a tribal society where all you're doing is pitting one culture above another. You're pitting one group against another. And it hasn't worked out well for countries like Afghanistan, Libya, Syria, and a whole bunch of others out there. And if we turn the United States into a tribal society, it's not going to work out well here. In order to assimilate into a society, you must be immersed in that culture. You must understand the history of the culture. You have to learn the language of the culture. If you take people from one country, put them in another country with the very same people, they're never going to gain this appreciation of the new country they're in. Instead, they're going to continue to identify within their tribes, within their groups. You know, Teddy Roosevelt, another quote, and I think, again, it's important. The one absolute certain way of bringing this nation to ruin, of preventing all possibility of its continuing to be a nation at all, would be to permit it to become a tangle of squabbling nationalities. And that's exactly what we're becoming, because it is a stupid idea that diversity is our strength. It's not. Assimilation is our strength. And we really need to smarten up and stop pushing this myth, because all it's doing is damaging our own country. Now, I want to thank you for joining me today. If you found this episode informative, please share it with your family, friends, and on social media. Take 30 seconds to write a review and leave a 5-star rating on any podcast platform that allows it. I want to thank you for joining me, and I'll be back on Monday with another great episode of the PAS Report Podcast.
Thank you for listening to the PAS Report Weekly Roundup Podcast.
Have a good one.
Bye.
Be sure to rate, share, and subscribe to the podcast, so you'll never miss an episode. Also, visit PASReport.com and follow us on Twitter @PASReport.